Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC Powers, and every Wednesday, I'm here mixing up cocktails with a her historical twist. So make sure to subscribe, follow me on Instagram, and that way you're not going to miss a single episode. Today's actually a special day for me. It is my fourth Cancerversary. Anything with the word cancer and it doesn't exactly scream fun, but it's a good day. I'm a breast cancer survivor, and as of today, I am 4 years cancer free. And you know, to honor that, we are raising a glass to an amazing breast cancer advocate. Although interestingly, we don't think of this woman as being a breast cancer advocate. We mainly think of her as being, you know, the darling of the depressions. She brought optimism to a nation beset by a financial crisis. I am speaking, of course, of Shirley Temple, or Shirley Temple Black, as she would come to be known. And obviously, Shirley Temple is a pretty obvious choice for Feminist Cocktail Hour in that she is not only a feminist icon, but she is also someone who has an iconic cocktail named in her honor. I'm speaking, of course, of the Shirley Temple. I guess it's more of a mocktail. And we're going to be doing a boozy riff on the Shirley Temple, a boozy poptail, actually, rather than a cocktail. And to make this boozy treat, you are going to need some rum, some grenadine, of course, it's a Shirley, some ginger beer, and some lime juice. Will you go wrangle all of that up? I am going to start the story of Shirley Temple Black. So Shirley Temple's story can basically be broken down into three acts. And the first act is the act that most of us are most familiar with, right? She was born in 1928 in California. Her father worked for a bank and her mother was, you know, a mother. When Shirley was only 8 months old, her mother noticed that she had a tremendous sense of rhythm. She would be in her crib, like, bopping along to the jams of the era. So as soon as Shirley could walk pretty much, when she was 3 years old, her mother enrolled her in dance classes. And it was in these dance classes that Shirley was discovered by a talent agent who cast her in a series of shorts from Fox called Baby Burlesques. And I know that, guys, this does not sound great, but it was like, you know, harmless stuff. It was little babies acting out, you know, grown-up movies, little spoofs. And one of them, for instance, Shirley played a version of Mae West and, you know, flirted with a bunch of baby soldiers. I realize it's not great. It's not a great look, but it was a great thing ultimately for Shirley because it got the attention of executives at Fox, and Shirley went on to be signed for a 7-year picture deal. She started out initially making $150 a week. And I know, doesn't sound like much, but you know, with inflation, that would be about $3,000 a week today. And with the deflation of the Depression, it would have had the buying power of like $18,000 a week. Not bad. Now, in spite of that fact, though, her mother, Gertrude, realized that Shirley should be doing better. I mean, her first three films, Stand Up and Cheer, Baby Take a Bow, and Bright Eyes, which is where the song On the Good Ship Lollipop comes from. You know, it's kind of a namesake for our poptail. The Good Times Shirley Pop, The Good Ship Lollipop. It's supposed to be cute, guys. Anyway, so these films were smash hits, and Gertrude negotiated for better pay for her daughter. Shirley ended up making $1,000 a week, with her mother being paid $250 a week as, you know, her personal coach and hairstylist. In addition to that, Shirley was given $15,000 as a bonus upon completion of any film. That $15,000 alone had the buying power of $1.85 million in contemporary money. Not bad for a girl who, you know, should have been off at kindergarten. You know what else isn't bad? Those cocktails that we drank in kindergarten, namely the kitty cocktail, aka the Shirley Temple. Now, a traditional Shirley Temple is made with grenadine, of course, ginger ale, a lot of ice, and some maraschino cherries. We're going to start with these, you know, classic ingredients. We're going to start right off with our grenadine. We're going to add 1.5 ounces of grenadine to our cocktail shaker. After that, we are going to add in 1 ounce of our ginger beer. Now, ginger beer is standing in for our ginger ale because the ginger beer, woo, is going to give us a little less of the sweetness that we would get from the standard ginger ale. Actually, Shirley Temple claimed that she was not fond of the Shirley Temple. She thought that the mocktail was, in fact, too sweet. P.S. to the old-timey bartender who made this drink initially, like, if you created something too sweet for that little saccharine dimple face there, you've gone round the bend, my friend. So the drink was invented by a bartender at the Brown Derby. This is where apparently, like, young Shirley Temple would hang out with other movie stars, and she'd sit at the bar complaining that the grown-ups got all kinds of charming cocktails and she had nothing to drink. So thus the Shirley Temple was born. This anecdote is just like one small example of how Shirley Temple did not have a normal childhood. Seldom was I sitting at bars complaining about how I couldn't get drunk with movie stars when I was in kindergarten. Shirley, though, when she was, you know, like I said, just out of kindergarten, she was doing things like winning Oscars. When she was 6 years old, she became the youngest person, still the youngest person ever, to receive an Academy Award. Between 1934 and 1938, Shirley Temple was the number one box office draw in the United States. And during that time period, she made more than 30 films with stars ranging from Gary Cooper to Carol Lombard to, of course, Bill Bojangles Robinson. She had her own bungalow on the Fox lot. It had a garden with room for her rabbits and was right next to a corral where she could go and ride her ponies. Her likeness was used to sell everything from Renault radios to Quaker Oats. There were Shirley Temple dishes. There were Shirley Temple jewelry boxes and jewelry and dresses. The Shirley Temple doll accounted for 1/3 of all doll sales in the United States during the 1930s. She influenced culture in countless ways. I mean, hey, she was the inspiration for this creepy surrealist painting by Salvador Dali. The girl was begging to become some kind of, you know, drug-addled teen tabloid star. But lucky for her, she was living under her mother, Gertrude, who was very concerned with making sure that Shirley didn't think too much of herself when she was outside of the studio. In fact, Shirley's home life basically revolved around Shirley's father. Not great, a little problematic, but, you know, standard for lives in the 1930s. It was important to Gertrude that her daughter remain grounded. Now, of course, there are some rumors that Gertrude may have been a little tough. You know, for instance, she did spank her daughter from time to time. Again, standard issue for the 1930s, but not great. There were also times when she would punish Shirley by apparently locking her in a windowless room in the dark and making her sit on a block of ice. I mean, it's just rumors. There were also rumors in the 1930s that Shirley Temple was not a child and in fact was a 30-year-old dwarf with fake teeth and a wig. Just rumors, right? None of it's true. Well, some of it's true, actually. Her teeth were in fact fake. That's why you never saw any Shirley Temple movies where she had, you know, a tooth missing. She would wear caps. Shirley Temple actually did lose a tooth while she was putting her handprints in front of Grauman's Chinese Theater. She decided to kick off her shoes and put her feet in barefooted in order to cover the faux pas in front of the reporters. She was a very smart little girl. She said that she wished her hair was a wig because she spent most of her childhood with fans coming up and tugging on her ringlets. Also, she had an incredibly rigorous hair regime. It involved like vinegar washes once a week, and every single night her mother would put exactly 52 curls into her hair before she went to bed. This rigorous routine prevented Shirley from partaking in fun activities. For instance, going swimming with Eleanor Roosevelt. That's something you want to put in your memoirs, but she had to decline because of the hair. The Roosevelts, by the way, were huge fans of Shirley Temple. FDR was quoted as saying during the, you know, throes of the Depression that as long as the country had Shirley Temple, we would be all right. I'm feeling all right, but I feel like I would be feeling great if we added some booze to this cocktail. We are going to add 1.5 ounces of rum to our cocktail shaker. This is taking, you know, our kitty cocktail into a grown-up cocktail. much in the same way that Shirley Temple quickly went from being a child to being a not child, being a teenager, being a young adult, as children are wont to do. As a teenager, Shirley's impish characters of her youth began to evolve into young women, and audiences were not willing to embrace this new Shirley. In 1939, she dropped from being the number one box office draw in the country to the number five box office draw. In the 1940s, Shirley only made 12 films, which, by the way, still a lot of movies, but, you know, considerably less than what she'd been making in the second half of the 1930s. It was also the 1940s that Shirley began her second act, her life as a wife and mother. And that might seem surprising, since again, at the beginning of this decade, she was only 12 years old. But in 1943, at the age of 15, Shirley met a soldier 7 years her senior, and 2 years later, she married him. In 1948, she had her first child. In 1949, she divorced that husband, and only 1 month later, she met Charles Alden Black. 11 months after that, Shirley married Charles, and on that very same day, December 16th, 1950, Shirley announced that after an illustrious film career, she was going to retire at the ripe old age of 22. And to Shirley's credit, this was like a legit retirement. This was not, you know, Barbara Streisand's 19th farewell tour. This was a legitimate retirement. She really didn't make any movies after 1950. She had a brief television series in the late 1950s, Shirley Temple's Storybook. But beyond that, she spent the years between 1950 and 1967 raising her three children and following her husband, who was a military man, around the country. I'm gonna add some lime juice to my cocktail shaker, just a half an ounce. And I'm not adding it at this juncture because I have any sour feelings about, you know, Shirley Temple deciding to be a mother and a wife. It's just, you know, time to add the lime juice. I think it's fantastic that she, you know, lived her life the way she wanted. And she herself was very grateful for the three different sections of her life that she had. The time she had as a movie star, the time she had taking care of her family, and then the time she had in the world of international relations. Maybe you didn't know that, but yes, the little colonel grew up to be the big ambassador. It all began in the late 1960s when she started becoming involved in Republican politics. And like, we can't be too surprised that she was a Republican, guys, because remember, she's a millionaire married to a military guy. It was bound to happen. In 1967, Shirley ran for a congressional seat in California. This is a time, of course, when young people across the country are protesting to bring our troops back from Vietnam, and Shirley decided to run on the platform of sending more soldiers to Southeast Asia. Needless to say, she lost this election, but a few months later, she found herself at a cocktail party with Henry Kissinger, as one does, and they were discussing Southwest Africa, and the next thing she knew, Richard Nixon had appointed her to be an ambassador to the UN. Shirley Temple would go on to be the ambassador to Ghana under Gerald Ford. She also became the first female protocol chair of the United States, making all the arrangements for Jimmy Carter's inauguration. She would also become the first and only female ambassador to the nation of Czechoslovakia. But perhaps Shirley's boldest activist moment happened at the beginning of her political career in 1972, when she announced that she had been diagnosed with breast cancer. And nowadays, that seems like nothing. But in the 1970s, cancer was really only discussed in whispered terms. And breast cancer was especially verboten. Women who died of the disease would often have obituaries full of euphemisms. You know, she passed away after a lengthy illness, or she died after, you know, a battle with women's diseases. These kinds of terms were what were used in papers. And more than that, celebrities very seldom talked about any ailment that might change their public persona. And on top of those stigmas, there was an additional stigma related to breast cancer because somehow it was sexualized because it dealt with the female anatomy. But in spite of all of this, Shirley Temple made the bold decision to share with the public that at the age of 44, she had been diagnosed with breast cancer. In fact, she invited reporters into her hospital room where she shared with them that she had a positive prognosis and she believed that other women could have the same as long as they, like she, detected their cancer early. And she advocated for self-breast exams. This, by the way, is exactly how I found my own cancer many years ago now. Shirley also advocated for the end of patronizing female patients. What am I talking about? Because we still patronize female patients, but it was a much more serious issue in the 60s and 70s. For instance, women would often be told that they were going in for breast biopsies only to wake up and discover that they had had both of their breasts amputated in a radical mastectomy. Doctors felt that women couldn't handle being told that they might lose their breasts, so they'd often lie to them and, you know, perform surgery on them without being given explicit permission to avoid this hysteria. God only knows the kind of trauma that these women experience, you know, in the post-surgical situation that they found themselves in, having had their breasts removed without their consent. On top of that, women especially, but patients of all kinds, had very little autonomy when it came to dealing with doctors. Doctors told you what your treatment plan was, and there was no conversation. Well, Shirley Temple was not there for that. When she was told she had breast cancer and that she had to undergo a radical mastectomy, she said no. A radical mastectomy, which was going to remove parts of her muscle, all of her lymph nodes, was unnecessary for an early stage cancer, and she instead had a simple mastectomy. She went on to say that while her doctor made the incision, she made the decision. You, my friends, also have a decision that you get to make. You get to decide how you're gonna drink this Shirley. You can have a dirty Shirley. Just take this, you know, cocktail shaker, give it a quick stir. Do not shake it. Remember, there's ginger beer in there. You can pour it over some ice and, you know, garnish with some maraschino cherries. Or you can do as I did, put it into a popsicle mold and enjoy a delicious boozy treat. I should know, by the way, that Shirley Temple did enjoy a very long life after her breast cancer diagnosis. Shirley Temple had 40 more years. She lived to be 85 years old, and much to the surprise of the public, she died of COPD. Surprising because she was hardly ever seen with a cigarette in her hand, even though she was a heavy smoker. She never wanted to, you know, leave a bad example for her fans. Shirley Temple left an amazing legacy. Her films brought joy to millions of people the world over. There is the legacy left by her work in the international community as an ambassador, but she felt that perhaps her most significant contribution was her breast cancer advocacy. After she came out with her diagnosis, other celebrities were inspired to do the same, including Betty Ford just 2 years later. And in the wake of these disclosures, the number of early screenings and early cancers that were detected skyrocketed. That is something that is certainly worth raising a glass to, or perhaps a pop to, a little popsicle to. Cheers, my friends. Let's give it a taste. It's good. It's very good. Look, it's a popsicle, but it's still a Shirley, you know. It has a little bit of spice from the ginger beer, a little bit of those sour notes from the lime. But ultimately, it's just like Shirley Temple herself, an enduring classic. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. Make sure that you follow, subscribe, and hey, if you had fun, come back next week. I'm going to have a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers!
Let's go, girls.